Initially, I just created a file of the works which I chose to, like all my notebooks. And then I created a module, like, you know, I created a list of that. And then, so initially when I did this thing, so I got few errors. Those were like along with the modules, my code and output were also being executed in my code, sorry, in my output. So then I kind of split them and used the NB path and all these things, and finally I put them in a for loop. As we were told to use a loop, I used a for loop, and then I used this append thing, got the output.
Can you talk a little bit more about the class that you wrote?
Sorry?
You wrote a class.
Oh yeah, yeah. Initially I took a class, and then I passed them. I used a special function.
What was the goal of using the class?
I mean, like, I tried various methods. Because I had a very big, I was getting all the outputs. Along with outputs, I was even getting, like all the graphs and all the every output. So I tried using class.
Did that become useful?
Yeah.
How did you use
it? That's what I was looking for, to try and figure out. So, like, so you use this, I'm not sure how, though. What was the advantage of using a class over just some functions?
No, I was just doing that randomly, and then I saw a blank.
Okay, so that, thank you.
Yeah.
So that was my question, because I hadn't seen the classes before, so.
Okay, I'll get back to you.
Hmm?
I'll get back to you after the class or something. I'll see.
Okay, yes. That's fine. But so I usually don't teach classes in this class, because we don't do a lot of object-oriented programming, and that's typically where you'd see that useful. So.
Yeah, I learned that in my undergrad.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay. Would we like to see another one, or should I follow another volunteer? So everybody did pretty well in this homework in the sense of, like, they saw what was going on. So, right, we'll move on. All right, so I was going to talk about scaling this evening. This is something that sort of a soft skill, in the sense of you're typically not going to be able to deliver like a very strict answer of like how things are going to work. It's more of a forecast. And so the relevance is, when you're forecasting, you need to know how you're going to grow, and that's often a business question. And so it becomes a soft skill of how do you translate technical requirements into business needs. That's usually where this skill shows up, is at that interface between technology and how the business is going to grow. All right. So the schedule is, we're coming up on the end of the class. We'll talk about elasticity. That'll be a discussion next week. And in preparation for that, you'll have some tasks associated with getting the cost for the cloud. So that'll be part of your homework tasking. One thing, so last week ran a little bit short because I didn't have the Python notebook that I wanted, and I spent the week getting it, and so now we have a little bit of a follow-up from last week on the use of Neo4j. So there were a lot of questions at the end of class of, like, how to use Neo4j. This is a somewhat silly example, so bear with me through its silliness, but to me it demonstrates sort of like why property graphs are useful potentially. And did I put it this way? Back over here. All right. So as a reminder of where we were last week, we were using a Python package called PyToNeo. So just for your familiarity, I have a Neo4j database instance running on my computer, and I'm going to use the PyToNeo module to connect to that. Thank you for the music. All right, so So I'm going to see if we can connect to the Python Neo Graph database today. If we can't, it'll be a short demo. So it'll take a little while. And then what I'm going to do is use our favorite Faker library to create a bunch of fake data. And this fake data is going to be people. So it's specifically names. And the people are going to be having relationships among each other, right? So, like, who's married to who had kids with whom, right? Like, that sort of type of relationship information. And also, who is working with who, who's coworkers, who's hired the other person. And so from that information, we'll build a graph where the edges are labeled by the relationship between the people, and the people will have different roles, right? So those are attributes that go on a graph. And then once we've done that, we'll build a really big graph and see whether we can find any instances where someone hired their relative, and that would be classified as, that'd be labeled as nepotism. All right, so Python is finishing up here. Yeah, okay, finished up. So now we'll run the rest of this notebook. So I think the graph creation can take quite a while, like a few minutes. So I'm going to have it get ahead of us while I explain the graph that we're building. All right, so basically this first part here is setting us up for, like, how would we recognize in a graph structure the relationships that we're interested in characterizing. So I'm going to flip back over to the graph viz. And the graph viz is just sort of making more explicit this concept of what a property graph is, with the edges being distinct. And this is how I'm building base family tree. So I'm going to visually walk through that process. So the way that I'm drawing a family tree is I'm going to have the parents, and then there's going to be a directed edge to the child. And so I've labeled these, and that's all in graph viz. So that's like an example of what you can do. I've colored some edges, I've labeled the edges, right? And all of that is being rendered then as a PNG. Now these names are picked randomly, so they just happen to be that relationship. But we can make a more realistic graph of what sort of like modern families may look like, right? So you have maybe two parents and three kids, right? So nothing too crazy there, but you can see the graph sort of gets more complicated as each kid has two parents. And then, like, maybe a modern family has, you know, multiple parents involved in the relationships, and you can still graph that. Right? Like, these two parents had this kid and this kid, and then this guy went off with her and made that kid. Okay. Still a graph that we can make and store information for. So once we sort of get the idea of what the family tree looks like, what would nepotism look like, right? So here I've built a graph where
this is like the historical definition of nepotism is you're hiring your nephew. So that's the relationship. So how would that look like in a graph? Well, you know, two grandparents who had one kid and another kid, and then the kid of these grandparents worked with this person to make this child, and then that person's uncle, the person, hired that person. Right. So this is a relatively straightforward concept of nepotism, hiring your nephew. But in a graph structure, like, that's the thing we have to look for. Right. So that's the sort of, like, you can think of this as the visual version of a query that we'd have to write to search the graph for that pattern of relationships, where we have both biological relations and a pairing relation. So that's why you'll sort of see, when we build the graph, we have to build a big enough graph that this randomly occurs. So it's in a real database, I'm looking through like non-random data, but here I'm just fake populating a bunch of people and their relations, and then seeing in that really big graph that I get anything that looks like this. So for all you SQL people who want to write SQL queries, you know, that's the thing that you'd have to write to capture that pattern out of a really big set of tables, right? Like, so see if this one popped up. All right. So that, although this is sort of like the biological relations, a more simplified picture of the actual query structure that we need to find is something like this. So that's the reduced, more efficient method of querying for nepotism. All right. So
So it looks like we connected to our graph. We deleted all the contents of the graph that were there previously from the last time I ran this thing. And then I'm going to write a couple of functions.
So again, this is Cypher, a domain-specific language for querying Neo4j graph databases. So this gets us to a trade-off that we'll revisit next week, which is like, when is it worth sticking with what you know versus transitioning to a domain-specific language? The usual reason why people use domain-specific languages is they're more efficient and effective at doing something complicated. That's why you would switch. But there's a burden, which is you have to learn how to use the domain-specific language and have all the software infrastructure that supports that. So there's some burden that goes with that. So we're looking at cost-benefit trade-offs next week. But this is me in the sense where I found it sufficiently advantageous to learn a new language to figure out how to query a graph database rather than writing SQL or some other layer, but they're just launching little queries into the graph and then running and returning some results. All right, so since the graph is empty, there's no nodes there currently, and the graph is not very exciting. And now my computer, there we go. All right, it's going through and eating up all my memory, so it's gonna be a little laggy. All right, so let's see, with 1,000 people, this is the set of parameters that we're going to choose to build the random populated graph. And we're having people who are married, people who have kids, and people who have co-workers. How many relationships sort of populate that set of people with?
So far, so good. Everybody's here. All right, so now we get into like the mixture of combining Python with Neo4j.
So this is the part where we're going to loop over a list for the number of people, and for each iteration in that loop, we'll populate a node in the graph. With this syntax from Python view, that's making a new node, and then we're going to make a list of all those people we need, and then push each one of those people nodes into the graph.
The graph is this remote database, we have to push it in there. Right, so that loop took 23 seconds to sort of populate the graph. Right, I skipped over marriage here because it turns out I don't end up using marriage. And then,
given the population of all these people, I said, let's find two randomly selected people and make a kit. So like we're just turning up, and then we're putting that relationship as edges back in the graph.
So just selecting random people, another 30 seconds there. All right, and then my last sort of like
connections that I need to make is hiring, right? And it's the same idea of like someone hired someone else at the directed edge.
We'll label it and we'll select two random people. All right. So now we're going to run some statistics to figure out how big is that graph.
Probably
because there was some collisions in the names and I didn't force them to be unique. So now we get into like, how do we,
once we've set up that graph, how do we run the type of query and get data back? And so this evaluate command, basically you have the type as a string, and then you launch it against the graph and you get a result back, but it's not exactly what we're looking for, right? So we're looking for how many relations between a parent and a kid are there, and then we'll count that and we'll get the number of kids, so the number of children per parent. And so we got back one result. That wasn't actually what we desired. It's because we had to store the output of that query to a variable and then go up and query the, or look at the value in the variable after running the query. So same thing here. This is, we're going to reformat this a little bit. So we've got the same query. We're going to run it in the graph. And then what it returns to us in the variable is this person.
And so this is a location. Where is the start of my data, basically? And so then you have to iterate over that cursor. Yeah, so we can get all the data back from that cursor, and then that is converted into a list.
So now we're, something that we're more familiar with, a list of dictionaries. And so I took out the top five entries by number of kids. So you can see this person here, Audrey Johnson, had 12 kids.
That's pretty high, right? You're like, in case you were wondering. All right, so now that we've got this dictionary structure, we can sort of do fancier things with the results, like format it so that it looks a
appropriate. And so the reason that we're turning this relationship 12 times is because it found the relationship between parent and child for Audrey Johnson 12 times. And she had 12 kids, so there's some duplicates in there. Nice. So, let's see. What do you hear? So that query that we ran was relatively simple. It's just looking for the relationship between parent and child. And so, to build up to our nepotism query, what I did is I added in more search terms until I got the construction that I wanted. And so, if we want to look for grandparents, like how many grandparent, parent, child relationships are there in the graph? I took the query that I initially wrote of how many kids are there, and then I added in another edge to that query. All right, so I'm looking for three nodes with two edges between them. And so you can sort of see that going from parent, child to grandparent, child. So here, the parent, child, like it's the same structure. I'm just labeling the types of nodes and the types of edges that I care about in that relationship.
Okay, so got back 36,000 query results for that match. And I can look at the top of them. And which one is this? Oh, yeah. And I look for how many great-grandparents, right? How long has that chain? And so because we've done a lot of children in these 1,000 people, turns out the chains are pretty long. So 20, is that right? Something wrong here. Longer chains for more people. Think about that. All right, did this finish? Yes. All right, so
now that I've sort of built up how I want to string these nodes and edges together, I need to build a relationship where a person hired another person. I'm going to label these like placeholder nodes as boss and kid. And I also want to find a relationship where the boss is the biological, yeah, it is unwritten. So the kid is the biological child of the boss. So it's like a direct relationship higher.
So how many of those? We got 10 back. And then we can get all the results back for those matches. So if you want to see what this looks like visually, let's run the same query over in the visual editor here. So I'm going over to my graph database to get a quick visualization of that relationships, and it's showing all the 10 parent-child boss my employee relationships. So nothing too exciting there. I mean, so I was kind of sneaky. I did not run that same graph query for the instance where I got back 26,000 entries, because that would just overwhelm the graph. The graph's Neo4j limited to 300 by default, so it won't render that many. All right.
As I mentioned, this is where either the child could have hired the parent or the parent could have hired the child, because this is an undirected edge. So in Cypher, to make this a directed relationship,
we can add little arrows. So this is the undirected version, and the directed version is just with
arrows in the direction we care about. So the boss is the biological child of the kid in this case, and the boss hired the kid.
So then we get three of those back. I would say there's fewer of them. All right, now the big question, did the nepotism find anything? This is not a guarantee. All right, perfect. So I was kind of worried because, like, if I ran this with an insufficient number of relationships or small enough size, I wouldn't actually get any results, right? It would just say like zero results returned. That would be sort of frustrating. So I cranked the number of relationships sufficiently high that I guaranteed myself to get something. So, all right.
Well, this notebook will be available, but if you're not going to go through it, it's that same visual sort of like set of relationships and nodes, but in a directed graph, sort of query in Cypher.
So, me, once you start reading through Cypher queries, I get sort of like
easier to understand, like the boss hired the kid, right? Like that's very, to me, understandable. So,
And then you can get back the data about what the actual relationships were found in this data. All right, then let's see, just out of visual curiosity, if we can get back the actual graphs here. Let's see. Awesome. Yeah, so this is probably an overzealous density, and so I actually have this person here hired Joe Clark, and this guy, his grandparents, this Jacob Martin, and Jacob Martin also had another kid, Ray O'Donnell, who had a kid, Joe Clark. So that little four nodes and those relationships, that's the relationships we're looking for, if you remember the notebook. This one. So that is what we're looking for, and you can go back and see the cipher query is pretty small and self-descriptive. So that's why for me in this case, Neo4j is a pretty straightforward language to pick up. Questions on that?
Yes. So hopefully the main takeaway lesson from last week was graphs are useful if you're looking at relationships. And so when I have a large number of complicated relationships between different entities, this person hired this person hired this person, and this person worked for that person, and sometimes it gets worse because, so what, where it becomes really useful is you often care about the ordering of events and the time at which things happen, right? So not only the sort of static graph, but sort of the time evolutionary graph. And in here, what's really nice is I can use, like this person was born on this date, you know, got hired at this date, fired from that job, went to this job at this date, right? And so then I can, once those are attributes in my graph, I can write time-bounded queries of like, this thing preceded that thing and happened before, you know, 1990. And so the complexity, again, of the sort of queries you can write, it's a very easy story to follow. Just like, you know, this is the thing I care about. Is it in the graph, right? And the graph is relatively compact as far as like the, you don't have to think about it as like a huge number of disparate tables spread out. So again, if I'm just looking for relationships, usually in data, a lot of the problems I work with are sort of graph oriented with timestamps, which I just don't know of a lot of things that are meant for that. Right? Like I can look at time series and I can look at tables of data, but then like when you mash those up together to, it's a story, right? Like my favorite example is Little Red Riding Hood, right? You can write Little Red Riding Hood as a graph database, right? Of like timestamp nodes and edges with relationships. And then like query that for what is the story in this graph. So the trick there is like you want a story of sequences of events with characters playing in the story, and then you want to know like query the graph and figure out what was the story. Anyone else? Not everyone. That won't be most people's jobs, by the way. So it's a subset of data science. All right. So that's all I have for Neo4j. Now we'll move on. All right. Estimation. So you'd think if I knew these slides were coming, I would practice these questions, but it turns out there's going to be some questions coming up, and I'll do it live, and we'll see how that works out. See if this comes up at all. Yes, all right. So the most common mistake that people make when they're making estimates is they worry about how precise their answer is. So because normally that's what people want. They want sort of like, is this going to happen or not? Is a different question of like, what was the exact measurement for the thing you're looking at? Right? We usually care about when forecasting what the accuracy of the model is, not so much the precision. So if those aren't familiar concepts, those will show up more for you in machine learning. But that's sort of like a major observation that people often get stuck on is they're like, well, I don't know it well enough. Well, that's fine. You can still proceed.
And then the other thing that distinguishes this from guessing is that you have documentation, right? If someone says, my guess is 5, okay, how did you come up with that, right? What was your reasoning? What was the logic? What was the basis for the decisions you made to get there? And like, so that's the other sort of thing that I often run into is lack of documentation on forecasting just makes it a guess. Even if you put in a lot of effort, like months of time to get to this forecast, it's still a guess. There's no documentation. All right. So this is the part I was warning you about. Of, I haven't gone recently, so I'm going to be doing this on the fly, and we'll see what comes. So the question is, we'll do a quick, let's see. So these are the four questions, and then I'm going to pull up a quick quiz, or not a quiz, a survey in Blackboard to figure out which one you want to vote for here. Polling, multiple choice, So we got four choices, and here are the choices again. All right, we'll come back and see what you guys have for answers. We have two for number one, so we'll go with it since apparently the I'm going to kill the Neo4j so it's not taking up so much memory. This one. Thanks. All right. Number one was how many people. How many people could you fit into UMBC library? That's the question.
Has someone here not been to the UMBC library? One. So, three. UMBC as a university has books, a library. I recommend going there and they have information. So, I have been to UMBC a few times, the UMBC library. I can't remember how many stories it is. And so, this is just like that point about decisions. I'll walk you through the reasoning of how it gets. So I'm gonna try and guess it probably has like 5-ish stories. So and then if I went to the library, if I go through this room and another room, so maybe like 3 of these might, right? And say another 4 in that direction. And then I'm going to keep the first basket of 80 people. Look behind in the corner. There's a sign that says next basket of 80. So I'm going to ignore that and I'm going to say it's 100. So this is a trick I'm using of rounding numbers that are easy to math. So 5 is sort of so, but 10 is better. Right? So I'm going to say there's 100 people in this room. And I said that there were 3 rooms that way and 4 rooms that way, so 2 times 4, that's 12. So 12 rooms at 100 people per room. 100 people, 4 by 3 rooms times 5 stories. Right, so this is a super quick estimate. Right? I did a little bit of math, tried to simplify my life, and did a visual sort of like analysis of how big I think the library is, how many stories there are, and then exploiting a little bit of local information that was available to me. So let's do the math. So I've got 1,200. So this is 12 and 100. Make this. Multiply that times 5. Again, this is a lazy estimation I'm going to make. And so 1,200 times 5, I'm too lazy for that. So I'm like, what? So, again, this is totally an estimation, and so the fact that it's like 1,200 versus 1,000, don't care, right? So, we'll cross that out, we'll call it 1,000, and then we'll multiply that times 5, and we'll get 5,000. But I don't care, right? In the sense of, like, I don't know how many stories there are. So, like,
Right? I don't think it's not more than 10, right? And it's definitely more than one. So that was my guess into it's 5. And so also, it gets sort of this question, this squishy question of like requirements. So how many people could you fit in the library, or how many people would be like up to the fire code limit, right? Those are two wildly different questions, because like you could probably fit 300 people in this room. Not where we're going for this point, but so this is sort of an estimate of 5,000 people in the library. So the fun thing, right, is go off to the library and see what their actual capacity is. I'm sure it's not 5,000, but somewhere in there. We didn't account for the fact that there were books in there, and so we'd have to like move all the books. But it's kind of a squish factor, right? You could say it's 1,000, probably not more than 5,000. So I would be curious if someone goes to the library between now and next Wednesday and reports back, you know, no bonus points, but I'd get my job. So let's just list out that skills we use. So what skills did we use? To get these numbers, you know, meta-analysis. What was it?
Guessing.
All right. But that is certainly a goal. All right. What else?
Estimation.
Okay, subdivide, yeah. Okay, what else? Okay, so the local knowledge. Okay. Well, that's the goal, right? But I would say rounding. Rounding was a crucial skill. And sort of like, I would say this is sort of like a Ben Payne personality for like, how much tolerance am I willing to make for like whether it's 80 versus 100? There's some sort of ability to understand the role of error bar, right? Like if this is 1200 versus 1000, you know, is that okay? It's a sort of like tolerance that you have some feel for. That's the part I don't know teach, so sort of like error bounding. And this is important, right? Because like if you were to leave out the fact that there's 5 stories, you'd only get 1,000 here. So. And then I would say the last thing that I'll mention is just sort of having some sanity checks. Right? So here we went back and said it's more than one story and less than 10. So we're bounding it, so we'll call that. It's not quite the same thing as air bounding. Sanity checks, I guess. So the same thing that we applied down here, the sanity check was, we're pretty confident the library can hold more than 1,000, more than 100 definitely, but maybe more like 1,000, and definitely less than 10,000, right, that'd be a city. So, but having some feel for what's a sane number is useful to sort of bound the ranges of the guesstimate. So that's why I had some hesitancy here. Guess makes it sound like you have no bounds, and you don't know like what an actual useful number is, because a guess could be like 1,423.6, right? That's also a numerical guess, but not as relevant.
That's kind of good.
Yeah.
But not good.
All right. So now we're going to, so I just showed you an example of one of the 4. So now it's going to be your turn. So, you know, the sneaky note is you should have chosen the hardest one because now you're going to have to do one of those. So. All right, so we're going to count off by sixes. I haven't experimented the other class, but I'll do it now. So we'll go off here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1. Okay, group of 4, and I'll go to group of 3. All right, so find your groups.
2, 2, Jack, you're 1.
Yep.
2. Travis.
All right, so take your group number, add 1, and then do that problem, right? So if you're in group 1, you're working on problem 2. If you're in group 2, work on problem 3. If you're in group 3, work on group problem 4.
Yeah.
If you need paper to write down your process, does anyone need paper? So here's the trick. Geographically dispersed, you're not all in the same corner of the room. If you're in group three, yes.
Oh, what?
Anyone need paper?
That was just way more than wrong.
Yes, I totally agree.
You want to say, we're doing a balloon covered one. So let's see, so one working on two working on three working on four, and then how they think the next iteration is four works on two. First four, you're working on two, five working on three, and six working on four.
How long?
Do you guys hear that? Which group are you? Five, so you're working on three.
Okay.
But anyway, what did you?
Never mind, it's three.
How many days you guys are taking it on average hour?
Wait, we have calculators. All right, give me one other minute, and then we'll do the next phase here.
Oh,
okay, so once you're wrapping up, gonna wrap up and find someone who's working a different problem.
Oh, okay.
What did you guys work on?
So we need to like scramble you into other groups. So that's phase, right? Find a partner.
Groups of two. So like you would meet up with someone else, and I would meet up with someone else, right? So like. Did you explain? Sorry, I didn't write that. Did you explain the logic and check it with the person? Okay, then you're good. Once you're done talking with your partner, it's break time. We'll come back at when this clock says 8:57. This is a perfectly reasonable size. It shouldn't cause you any problems on your computer. The file size restriction was on the notebook, not the data. Regions that are geographically adjacent to each other, right? So if you say like this neighborhood pays more taxes than this neighborhood, that'd be new information that you have.
we haven't been able to figure that out. I could ask, I mean, like, there's just a lot of questions, like, how many houses per neighborhood? What's the total tax income per neighborhood? Right, so there's, I think you can, there are questions that you can ask of this data if you keep it. Yeah, I would keep the other one, because then you can say, like, all of these houses are clustered in the same group. And then, like, how much money is that group, you know, making for me in the tax base? How many houses are there? I think you can do more in-depth analysis. All right. On the data side, you know, this is your notebook tree. Yep.
Yeah, that's exactly.
People don't want to come back, I guess.
Okay, I'm going to get started. We're running a little bit of past where I thought the break would go. So it's a little embarrassing sometimes when you read a Dilbert comic and you're like, wait, that's my life? How is that? Like, so has anyone here gone through this sort of work before? Have a yes? Well, I mean, like, in the fact of, like, has someone asking you for an estimate and being confused as to why it's an estimate when they ask for an estimate? No. I get this. So, like, my job is forecasting, and so, like, this happens all the time. Like, you gave us an estimate. Why can't we hold you accountable to it? Well, it's an estimate. So, you know, the whole idea of forecasting to me is, like, a tough job emotionally because people aren't expecting answers, because that's usually what is taught is an answer, right, or what's expected. So this is like an emotional challenge of forecasting to prep yourself for, that people typically don't know how to engage with that information because it's challenging to work with, right? Like, people want to make hard estimates of this thing will happen at this time, therefore we should do this, right? That's a very clear decision story. Whereas if you say, well, I think this will happen, and like, well, I can't think a decision, right? You have to do a thing. So that's sort of like where the disconnect comes from. All right. So, and in data science, there's not only the typical, you're doing data science often to make a forecast, but even with the resources that you're in charge of. Like, let's say, like, my boss wants to know from me whether I'll need a bigger computer next year, right? Because they're going to have to go off and buy a thing. So they have a clear decision that they have to make. And I have to tell them my forecast of whether or not I'm going to need more compute. And so it happens both for, like, the output of your job, but also the job itself requires forecasting. So, and then this one bites me a lot is, like, how long will it take for you to do this job, right? That's, like, a very common programmer analytic of, it will take me 10 hours per line of code, right? And, like, well, that's clearly unreasonable. Well, okay, tell me what you want. Like, it's in this debate, right, of, like, how long will it take? And then, like, waiting for your analytic to produce data, it is very useful to figure out, like, I ran 10 iterations of this loop and it made 1 gigabyte of data. Therefore, if I have 1 million iterations of this loop to do, I'm going to need more storage, right? Like, that's the sort of estimate that you will use as data scientist to estimate out, can I even finish this program, or is it going to take too long, use too much compute, too much memory? Those are the things that you'd rather not find out once your hard drive is full, that the analytics not going to finish. Right? That would be meaning you wasted your time. So this is something that I use quite a bit to figure out, should I go on break, or should I go to lunch, or should I leave for the day? Right? That's the sort of costing estimate of, I don't want to wait that long, so I'm going to go do something else. And for me, it is second nature, because like, that's all the time, so it's not a way of life for some people, so it's sort of a weird mindset to be in. Yeah. So like, this is my bias, like, always do estimates, right? Always be making predictions, because that's how you'll gain the skill. If someone asks you to do some forecast and you've never done it before, it won't be surprising when you don't know how to do it or the estimate comes out poorly, right? And so one way to train yourself is constantly be making predictions of, like, is this guy ahead of me walking to the coffee shop or the library or a classroom, right? And like all these sorts of like personal sort of like stories that you can tell, like, okay, he's got a book bag on, he's going to do it, right? So like these little stories, you can look for evidence. Dana's having a good time over here.
Like every person in front of you.
Absolutely. Does not everyone do this? Right. So the story there is like, if the data exists, right, leverage it. And but that requires some curiosity to try and tie elements of a evidence together into a story. So all right. So yeah, this is back to people asking me for forecasts about total cost of ownership. Like, how much is this computer going to cost us, right? Is it going to cost us hardware, or is it the hardware and the operations and maintenance? Or is it the hardware and the operations and maintenance and the system administrators? Or is it the hardware and operations and maintenance and system administrators and the electrical power and the cooling and the data center and the security staff to run the computer? Right? And you're just like, where does that story end exactly? And so one trick that I have for you is that when someone asks for a forecast, they're either asking for an absolute, sort of like, this is the thing I care about, or more typically, management wants to make a decision between two things. And if you can figure out what those two things are, it makes your forecasting requirement easier, because all you have to do is look at the cost difference, not the absolute cost. So if someone says, I want to run this computer over here, and how much does that cost? They're really asking, how much is it if I do it over here versus over this one? And then you can look for the relative difference between those two to get a cost difference rather than the absolute cost of each solution. So look for relative cost estimates is the choice there. All right. So now we've done some math skills, right? Mental math skills, sort of mindset. Why do we as data scientists care? Well, has anyone here not heard of the 4 V's of big data? Yeah. So this is a sort of advertising by IBM. They're very smart people. They have smart people there sometimes. But this is them trying to say that big data is complicated, right? And like then they give off all these reasons. As you'll notice, right? They've got numbers on there. They've got words. They've got lots of colors. They've got little icons. This is actually a PR slide. They are wanting to sell products to do compute on big data. Therefore, they have to convince you, you have a big data problem. So this is why would IBM try to educate the consumers? Because they're educating them towards the problem. So be wary of that. But so big data is a buzzword you've probably heard. My definition is way different than this, right? This is a great advertising and marketing slide. This doesn't change my life as a data scientist, right? So I'm going to try and change your life with this next slide. So big data is more than what you're used to, right? You're used to working on an Excel spreadsheet. Anything that does not fit in an Excel spreadsheet is big data to you, right? But if you're used to working on gigabytes of data, you know, on a MapReduce cluster, an Excel spreadsheet is not big data. So it is contextually a subjective question of what are you used to? Questions on that? That's my definition of big data. And the reason it's life-changing is because when you go off and talk to someone,
you have to figure out what is the basis of their perspective of the world, right? If their basis of how they operate is they use Jupyter notebooks, they're comfortable at the desktop level, but they've never gone beyond that, then when you confront them with a problem that requires more than what they're used to, they're going to need some education, right, and some understanding to understand what is the challenge at this different scale. So you always have to figure out, where is your customer? Where do they live, right? Are they living paper and pen? Do they live in email? Do they live in their Excel spreadsheets? Do they live in large-scale databases? Do they live in, like, large clusters? So understanding that is helpful, because if you come in and you say, a Jupyter notebook is big data, and they're just like, what does that mean? Like, I live in Excel spreadsheets. I don't know what that means, right? So you have to figure out where that gap is. So and then the consequence of, like, when you've identified these different scales of operation, there's different skill sets at each step. And so I've been primarily focusing you sort of on the one Excel spreadsheet to one hard drive range of scale, right? So, like, that size of data you should probably feel more comfortable dealing with in this class than before you came to the class, hopefully. And so the scale that we haven't gotten to is sort of like, sort of cluster, large system. That'll be hopefully in your the databases class coming up. And then there's, I think, a Data 603 class covers this. So this does come up in this curriculum. But each of them has a different skill set. So, all right. And there's some course on it. But the actual sort of measurable thing is that these are different sizes. So we'll say, like, 1,000 lines fits well in an Excel spreadsheet. And also fits well in these other tools, but if you fit the same 1,000 rows of an Excel spreadsheet into, like, a huge cluster of computers, you're wasting that effort, right? And so it's sort of right sizing the size of your data to the size of your infrastructure is important. So I used some abbreviations on the previous slide. If you'll notice, like, GB and TB and MK and all these different things, and some of you hopefully were perplexed and haven't seen those before. So this is a slide to figure out what all those things are. So this is something that I would recommend memorizing. And the reason I say that is because if someone says megabyte and gigabyte, you should have in your mind a relatively concrete image of what that looks like. Right? Is it a song or a movie, right? Or is it the largest computer on Earth, right? Like what is the actual scale of these numbers? And so it's useful in your head to have some mapping of when someone says, I'm going to hand you a petabyte of CSV, and you're just like, okay, that's how I got Jupyter. No, you should not say that, right? Like, so you should say, wait, let's have a new conversation, right? Like, so this is why it's sort of important to have these numbers memorized, because when your customer comes to you and says, like, I want you to do this, you're going to say, no, we need to have a different conversation, right? So now we've sort of talked about the actual sort of increments of size, and this is one of the sort of first guesses that people make is that, well, you know, the larger you get, the more money you need, right? This is a pretty straightforward linear relationship. Problem solved, right? How hard is scaling? That's all it is, right? And no, that's actually a lie. So, and by the way, here's a joke. You can read this one. But. Okay. All right, so that previous slide with this linear line relationship between the size of your data and the amount of money you need to spend or anything else, it's not flat. It's not some linear slope. And the reason why is because hardware isn't scalable in that sense. So typically, when you look at your computer, it has a certain number of cores, right? And like 2 or 4 or 8. And so that means, like, if you think you're just going to get, you know, 27 cores, like, it'll just scale, right? No, it doesn't usually do that. So that's not how hardware works. And so same thing applies for memory. Like, you can't just buy an arbitrary number of gigabytes of RAM for your computer. And so hardware doesn't scale linearly. It scales in a step function. So that shouldn't be so shocking, right? Like, this is an obvious slide. But the consequence of that is when you go off and do things, you have to build that into the story you're telling about the scalability of the project you're working on. And so we know that hardware doesn't scale linearly, but the consequence is, like, for certain scales, when I double the size of my memory, or the amount of data needed, it doesn't change anything, right? Like the size of the hard drive is still larger, and so it doesn't matter. But sometimes there are transitions. You double certain data sizes, then you will step over that boundary. And so knowing, relatively speaking, where those hard boundaries are in hardware is helpful to understand the impact of your scalability.
So even like if you were creating instances of the same type of program to like slice and dice it,
yeah,
then you'd all of a sudden like blow your computer up.
Well, not that you'd blow your computer up, but just the program would stop working.
Right.
Yeah. So this is like trying so that it's much easier in your head to linearly extrapolate. Like 10 rows took me 10 minutes, therefore 1,000 rows take me 1,000 minutes. That might not work out, right, if the hardware resources you're on are constrained so that they don't scale like that. So the linear scaling I just told you about, throw that out of your mind. It usually doesn't apply when you're hardware bound, and you're always hardware bound.
So what does that mean? Well, that means that you actually have something where if I double in size from, say, 20 megabytes to 40 megabytes, it doesn't matter, right? You're still at the same level of cost. Right? Whereas if I go from, say, 8 terabytes to 16 terabytes, maybe I do need to step up in the hardware side, and therefore the cost is going to be larger. And so this is like the first introduction to why forecasting and estimation and scaling is a little bit complicated, because you have to know where are these steps, right? Both in terms of cost and where are the steps in terms of size.
And then you have to do this survey of like what's available, who's selling what, right? And then like, so you'd think, okay, hard drive costs, you know, so many dollars per gigabyte, and my CPUs cost this much, and then I can go off and have a good life, right? Well, it turns out these steps are dynamic, right? They're changing every 6 months, basically. And so every time you do a forecast, you have to figure out where are the steps in my decision process, and then wait 6 months and do it again, right? And it's like you're constantly having to update based on market availability to figure out what the cost of your project's going to be. And you could think, well, maybe I'll just like take all this and we'll use Amazon in the cloud and not have to worry about hardware, right? Has anyone thought that? And the prices are dynamic, right? Because Amazon faces the same issue, right? And so they're going to pass the cost on you or the cost savings in the same manner. And so when you go to Amazon and you do the cost estimates, they have step functions also for their hardware, and they have dynamic pricing. And so you can't get away from it even if you give someone else the problem.
This is a problem you're stuck with whenever you scale, regardless of whether it's, yeah, Alex.
How often do I look at scaling?
Yes.
Probably once every 3 months. But again, my job is forecasting, so this is my life, right? Like, I have to figure out what computers to buy, when, for how many years are they gonna last, all this stuff. So let's say you're not Ben Payne, right? And you were working at a small startup company and needed to buy some computers for your data science project, right? This is a question of, well, how big do I expect my little data science startup project to get? Right? Well, it's going to get really big because we're going to be really successful. Okay, then you should buy a bunch of hardware. Well, we're a really small company. We don't have any hardware to, you know, budget to buy all that information, right? So then we're going to have to buy really small systems. And even in like a small business or an organizational unit in a large corporation, you still face the same problem of trying to buy what you need to facilitate the business aspects, but minimize the cost to the business of doing that operation. Absolutely.
So like at work, we have a server room that we're like replacing everything in. Like the servers are probably not more than 5 years old, but just the stack has gotten too old, so we've been replacing it. So this is like a whole room, like probably 1.5 times the size of this room, kind of semi-filled with servers. And we bought like $2 million worth of, they call them like super dense Dell like servers. And it's literally just like the size of your like small closet at home, like two of them next to each other, like literally could do everything that we've been doing in our home for like 4 years more, but it costs an arm and leg for those things.
Yeah. So the scale there is useful. So John mentioned like $2 million for, these are called racks of equipment. So typically you have computers in racks rather than like on a desktop. And so
he's mentioning $2 million, right, for these two racks of equipment. Well, imagine filling up an entire room full of these systems, right? These are things that will make or break a small business or an organizational unit in a corporation. So your budget for hardware has to last you, right, 3 to 4 years. And so therefore, you have to make this big upfront investment and hope the business sort of covers the cost amortized over the years that you have the equipment. So these get to be pretty sensitive business decisions about how much money do you think we'll make in the next 5 years, how much hardware should be on the next 5 years, right? It gets really sensitive.
And like, especially since this is, I don't want to say it's like a new thing, but like it's definitely growing, so it's very easy to like underestimate, which is something that like the business I work in is basically now, but underestimate the cost of these systems.
Yeah, so there's danger in both ways, right? So if you overestimate how much compute resource you'll need, then you spent too much money and either didn't need it or can't figure out how to use it. The other side of that, like if you underestimate, so let's say I only buy a few computers, right? So I came in under budget, which sounds good, until someone has a business need and it can't be satisfied because you don't have sufficient compute resources. So you're screwed either way, right? If you guess too high, guess too low, that's bad. And so that's why forecasting gets to be this little, you know, it affects the stability of the business and the ability of the business to grow. And it's this constant feedback loop, right? Which is going back to your question, Alex, of like, why are we doing this so often? It's because it's that feedback loop needs to be that frequent. Any other war stories? Another nectar?
I was going to say telecommunications writ large. A lot of people don't understand that a lot of the wire that's out there is actually garbage and it's not being used at all. Out of an expectation that you trench it, in other words, bury it. Having to bury the wire, make sure it's protected so that when you do need it, it's turned on. They don't expect that wire to be used potentially for years, but they do expect the rate of data to only increase over time. And those decisions are billions of dollars.
Yeah. So my sister needed to get internet to a city, and so the cost per mile of laying the fiber in the ground was $30,000 per mile. Yeah, and imagine trying to wire up a county, right, in a state. Like, that's a significant outlay of money.
And not being able to use, or not using all the wire at that time.
Fiber. Yeah, so like, this is, again, like the numbers get kind of mind-blowing, right? Because I'm used to like paying for gas, it's like $30 a tank, right? I could buy groceries, it's $50, right? But like, you know, $30,000 a mile and we're doing a county, like, that's a lot of money, like, right? But the business analysis is often like, if we do this huge outlay of like laying all this cable in the ground, your customers aren't going to be able to pay for that back to your spent cost, right? So like, let's say every customer you deliver fiber to is going to pay you $90 per month, right? And I've got 1,000 customers, right? So that's $90 or $100 per 1,000 customers. So that's $10,000 per month, right? Back just in the gross profit, right? But now we got to figure out, got to pay all your workers, right? And it's super messy. So your role as a data scientist, people are going to come to you because they think you know math and computers, right? And a little bit of whatever domain expertise you're in. So good luck. All right. Yeah. So basically, this is a slide on basically the hardware is messy. And then to make your life worse, right? Because that's what I'm here for, is that your language that you need may change. And so, so you may want to get faster or larger, and that makes the problem even more complicated because sometimes you need different hardware for different languages. It's messy, right? So an easy example here is the interplay between, let's say I'm running my analytic in Python, and now I need to do some machine learning, so we need some GPUs. Well, now we're back into that hardware state, right? So GPUs are changing every 6 months. Which GPUs are going to buy? Are they going to be useful a year from now? Right, like, can you turn back the cost of that GPU in 6 months that you're using it? You know, that's a big question. All right. So, if I haven't connected you with you yet, we'll try again. So, all of these things of the things that you're used to working, your environment, right? Your hardware, your software, the algorithms you're using. Every time that you change out of that, it's a cognitive load. You have to change how you think about the problem. and you have to invest a bunch of your time in rewriting a solution to take advantage of whatever change you implemented. So all of these things, they represent effectively cost and therefore barriers to change. So when someone says, I'm going to give you 10 times more data, if the method that you're currently using can't handle that, you're going to have to change and you have to learn something new. And you're going to have to waste a bunch of time rewriting whatever code you have in the new method. And so these are the things where you will be impacted if someone changes your problem on you. And it's highly likely that you will not be working on the same problem for 20 years. So change is ahead for you. How often do I program in C? Never. I always leave the problem before it gets that bad. Literally, there's a guy next to me who can write assembly, and like I'm so happy because what that means is I don't have to write assembly. I can just give him the problem, right? Like, so it's good to have a diverse sort of like work group that you can pawn work off to where they appreciate having problems. Because often, right, people who write C in assembly don't want to go off and socialize and like go to all the meetings, right? So there's a little bit of give and take trade you can make, right? Okay. All right, so do I have time for another? Yes. All right, so I'm going to go into an example of where bigger data than you're used to can cause you problems that you weren't previously thinking about. Okay, so I'm confident no one has heard of the Rhine test, but the story here is there's a guy who thinks he can run tests on people to detect telepathy, right? So the ability to like know what someone else is doing, right? So that seems like a pretty strong claim that we'd have to test, right? So he comes up with a test. He says, here's 10 cards. If you can guess the content of these 10 cards I'm holding, then you're going to pass the test and be qualified as a telepathic person, right? Sounds straightforward. Right? And the ability to guess these 10 cards, right, is very limited. And so like if I ask Sophia, like, tell me what 10 cards I'm holding, right? You don't know, you're gonna make some guesses and then like you'll fail the test, right? That should be the expected result. Okay, so if you're a statistics person, you'll realize that if I run this test a sufficient number of times and people make random guesses for the 10 cards, occasionally someone will guess the right answer, right, for all 10 cards. And you'll be like, holy crap, you're telepathic, right? This is seriously what happened, right? And so then the right? So this is like a miracle, right? So okay, this is science, we have to verify, right? And so we're gonna take Sophia, she passed the test, she gets all 10 cards correctly. All right, we'll wait 2 weeks, we'll run the same test. And Sophia, can you guess these 10 cards? And the answer is gonna be, statistically speaking, no. Right? He guessed the 10 cards twice, you know, and then so the problem was that he detected that telepathy goes away after a certain number of days, right? So that's the Rhine paradox, but okay, so you think that's a silly example. No one would ever do that, right? I mean, it did happen, but so then the government made this wise decision of, we'll do the same thing, but a slightly different problem, where we look at all the people, right, for suspicious behavior. That's a good way of catching terrorists. Sounds reasonable, right? And so it in some sense doesn't matter what you look for. If you look at a large enough population, you'll find examples of what you're looking for. Right, as long as the statistical population is large enough and the features you're looking for is small enough, you'll find a match. Right? And so the problem is, when they ran this, for the U.S. population they're looking at, they get back like 10,000 people are terrorists, right? Because they matched in all these different features, right? It's basically like the card guessing turned out to be correct. Like, even if your population only had 10 actual terrorists in it, like, you'd get all these feature matches for tens of thousands of people. And so like you didn't actually solve much of it, because somewhere hidden in those 10,000 people that had the matches are maybe some of the 10 people who are actually terrorists. So this is a scaling problem, because if you're looking for something that you think is really unique, but then you apply it to a really big population, you'll find a match. So let's do that. This is a data science class. We should do it. All right. So let me pull open a notebook. Oops, not that one. Yeah. All right. So this is not quite as an amazing as the card story, right? But it kind of delivers the principle of play. So I'm going to make a string of characters, and the string of characters is going to have 10 randomly selected letters in it. Right? So this is sort of like you're driving down the highway and you see license plates. The license plates are effectively a collection of random numbers. Right? So I'm going to use a couple different libraries here. Hope that it runs. Okay, so again, let's see how many, why this takes so long.
There we go. So I'm going to pull from this list, right? This is my sort of like population of things.
I'm going to pull with repetition. So that means I'm choosing 26 characters for the first character, 26 letters for the second character, and so forth. And so
26 choices, blah, blah, blah. The 26 to the 10th power is this number. It's really big. Right? That's the part you care about. How many different 10 character combinations are there?
That many. Okay, how many is that? Well,
I did this little sort of preview for you. So hundreds, thousands, millions, billions, trillions. So there are 141 trillion different permutations of 10 characters.
So far, so good. That's just some math. Right? No estimation needed. All right. So
now I'm going to write a little bit of for loop to randomly choose one of the 26 characters and then put that in a little bit of a list, do that 10 times, and then I'll have some random characters. So this is some random 10 characters, and that took a little bit of time.
So list comprehensions can do it faster, so we'll use list comprehensions to do it. And then
I'm going to write this crazy function. Right? This crazy function generates a 10-character string and then looks for a pattern in that string.
All right, so let's walk through this. Yeah.
So right, I'm going to pass it the string that I want to match. In this case, it'll be the character 8. And I'm going to have a certain number of random strings to inspect. So that'd be like the 10 character strings. I'm going to do 10 of those. And then the string length here is n, is also 10. And then I'm going to print.
I will say yes. All right. So, where'd it go? There we go. All right, so I did
10 generations of this random string set, and then I asked, did A show up in any of them? And it turns out that there were 4 of those that matched letter A.
So, nothing too crazy going on there. Let's look for something a little more unique, right? So, does AAA ever show up? And the answer is no, right? That's
some ordered sequence of characters specifically is pretty long
relative to the overall string length, so it didn't show up. So we're just like, oh man, we didn't find the terrorist, or we didn't guess the card match, right? So this is sort of, how likely is this? Well, do we expect it to show up, right?
So the probability of finding an A or an A or an A is one of the 26 characters in the first location, one of the 26 characters in the second location, and so forth, right? So that probability of finding A in a sequence of 3 characters is this value, very, very small, that you care about.
And then I actually didn't care back in this function where the AAA shows up. Does it show up at the very beginning or the second set, right, and so forth? And so in order to figure out whether the AAA should show up anywhere in the 10 character string, I have to basically add that probability 10 times, because it could show up here or here or here or here, therefore it's addition. And so the, let's see if I can calculate that. Okay, so the probability of finding
AAA anywhere in a 10 digit string is 1 in 4 over 10,000.
So it's still a relatively small number. So that's why up here when we ran it against 10 different strings, the probability of finding AAA was pretty low, so it's not too surprising that we didn't find it.
Now we get into the Bonferri's principle, is that if we increase the number of things that we're looking in sufficiently, we will find that pattern.
And this isn't some like rocket science, right? It's just like increase the number of tests and we'll find a thing that's more, but that's less likely. Okay, so now I did a little bit of different math, right? So I said,
if I run 10,000 tests,
and the probability of finding AAA somewhere in that list of 10 characters is this amount, then what is the probability of finding the AAA in the 10 strings, the 10,000 instances? Well, 4.55.
What does that mean? It means if we run the test 10,000 times, we'll get it roughly 4 times. So let's do that. Woo!
All right, Matt, came through for us. So here it got 6. That's just some random variation, right, in the number of returns. But so it's roughly close to 4.5. So we're feeling pretty good that we wrote some code that checks out mathematically.
Awesome. All right. So the question for you is, yeah. So I have. This is how many times should it show up in it, and if I run 10,000 tests. Now, so we took the way we got the number was we took the probability of finding AAA in a 10-character string, we multiplied times 10,000. All right. So here's the challenge for you that I'm going to give you some code and some time to work on writing the code. So I need a function that takes 2 strings, right? So here we could use, like, the string AAA and the string BBB, and did those show up in my 10 random characters. This is like an in-class exercise. So I'm going to give you this notebook, and the thing that I want you to be able to run is this command, right? So I'm passing you 2 strings, and I want you to figure out how many times those 2 strings show up for a certain number of runs. Questions? I'm going to give you the code. I'm going to give it off. And hopefully. All right. So you will need to open your computer and go to a website and download that notebook so that you can run the code. All right, and I'm gonna show you where the notebook is in case this link is not, it should be correct. Yeah. There we go. Okay, so
this is the same website that we were using for your notebooks in Project View. So there's a notebook there, be able to download that. I'll pull up the address again just to make it super readable.
Okay, and I'll probably give you about 5-ish minutes. Don't worry if you don't complete the problem in that time, but this is the thing that I want you to work on. And I'll be here so you can ask me questions while we're working on it. So we went to this website. And then I will right click on it and I'll say save link as, and we're even save file as, whatever it's called. Oh, there we go. All right. So I would just download it like that. Sure. So other way you can click on it, it will take you to the page. And then I think, where is it? Yeah, if we go to raw, I think.
Yeah.
This is the actual content. You can also just save this to disk. To like a save as. Okay.
And the function that you're writing is at the very end of the notebook that's been posted. So you just need to write that code in.
I'm
do that.
Let's go back to the idea. So I think that right click. Save that. Yeah, so we need some effects that I can do all of them. Get rid of the box.
I saved it in the text and so it's text.
And you're able to write the book.
Yeah.
So you got the two pins. Two.
I read the
book. Okay.
Yeah.
You're able to write the function.
So the patterns that we're looking for.
You're looking for either of them. Yes. So clarification from Jack. The two strings you're looking for, either of them show up in the 10 characters. Yeah, okay.
All right, so I'm going to give you about 2 more minutes, and then we're going to pair up. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Are we ever going to get to the how to phone the language? Well, I mean, like,
yes, so I think I was thinking about explaining all the different variations on that. Yes. Brad, I'm curious to see what you have.
Are you even done?
Yeah. Perfect. All right, so if you're not done at this point, or if you are done, find a partner. You can be physically adjacent or somewhere else, but find a partner and compare what you've got so far. This is my way of getting everybody into a synchronous barrier of being done. All right, pair up.
So if you're still struggling with this, the straightforward copy-paste method is to take the onMatch function and then alter the line that matters, which is this one, to reference two different strings. Right? So that's like a gimme, I guess, make the program relatively easy. So this is the modified version with the OR statement. So looking for A or B, that's cool. So what? If we run that function,
when I ran the function, I got 15 results. You're like, before we weren't getting anything, now we're getting a whole bunch of results, right? You're just like, whoop,
that's exciting, right? But, I mean, it's not mathematically that exciting because
all we really got was the 15 results is just 4.55
times 2, right? So it's like the 8 you'd sort of expect. So, all right, so the original expectation here was 4.55 for a 3-character match. We did 2 of those, we got a little more than 8, so that, you know, that's cool. All right, that's all I got. All right, so now it's break time.
So let's break until 9:51. On that card.
Yes.
We'll put it as classroom clock. Question. Yes.
So what I've done here was I did not include the assignments.
You didn't have to send your
did not include the folder that I picked.
Yes.
So that's the case I've made a new folder and just found a few files.
Okay. Yeah.
So those files are going to be and those files are going to be.
So how many notebooks were in your analysis?
It was more than five. I mean,
okay.
So so these are the five that's included before.
Okay. So when so can you run your notebook?
I will do that. So I've done a few more files now.
Okay. So this same notebook?
Yeah, this is a little bit.
But with more Python
with
notebooks.
Yeah, with more. I mean a little more.
Okay. And it's the same functions. Okay. So you're requesting additional credit. Can you send me an email reminder?
I should.
Okay.
The reason behind that was I actually misinterpreted your question. I was not there for the last afternoon. So I was really prepared other than But this, I haven't included all my assignments. So that's it.
I would highly recommend reading the rubric for future assignments.
Rubric was giving me
Yeah, the grading is for the rubric, and then this is the assignment description. So
yeah.
Those are the ways to figure out what the assignment is.
Okay, the rubric was telling them after submit by the end of file, and then that goes to the rubric, right?
So the rubric is typically has the grading method, and the assignment description describes what the assignment should be.
Yeah, but the rubric was only giving me...
Yeah, the points.
The only the point. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's the same rubric that we get for every
assignment. Every coding assignment gets the same rubric. Yes.
So
sorry, I should say the rubric and the assignment. Right.
So the assignment description. So once I after I saw that assignment file should not be included in this folder, so I thought I'll have to include all the assignments. So that.
You're saying the assignment description is incorrect?
No, that's what I understood.
Oh, right? Okay. I see. So you misread.
Yeah. Files used for this, used for code other than assignments.
Yeah.
So I thought, okay, I should not include any assignment work in my.
Okay.
That is the reason I missed answering.
Got it.
Right.
Okay.
There's an example for it, work from other courses. That's it. So that is the reason.
Okay. Okay. So the takeaway from the section that we talked about is basically that scale matters, it's discrete. Not continuous, that's why it gets messy. And there are things that will arise at larger scale. So often it gets really frustrating. You'll see bugs that only occur at scale, not at the scale you're testing at. And so when you make your program larger, more data, you encounter new bugs, and that's always exciting. Okay. All right. Let's see. Yeah, I know, right? It's going to be a late class. All right, no. All right, so this is a quick exercise. Shouldn't take too long, but I think it's pretty vital, so I'm not going to skip over it, because this is actually another soft skill that I wanted to sort of, like, let you think about. So these are things that you'll almost always say, in some situation, I don't have enough skills, and I need to go get help. And so that's like a relatively common situation inside data science and outside data science. So whatever the situation is, you'll find yourself looking for help from other people. And the question is, like, what do you do, right? Like, so why would someone else work with you? What's the value in that helping you, right? This is a thing that you're going to have to figure out for your projects. And one of my jobs, which I really enjoy, is influencing other data scientists. Like, that's... I don't like to use the term, but yes. So what do I do is I try and figure out, like, what's the direction we need to go and how we're going to get there, right? That's the sort of thinking. And so this requires figuring out where the gaps are in the organization and for individuals. And that gets into a touchy subject, right? It becomes, what do you not know? Therefore, you need that. Right? And people are typically not super vulnerable in exposing their weakness. So that gets the job to be harder, because identifying the gap really means what is your weakness. So that gets a little personality skill. All right, but here's your task. So you are going to write down your weaknesses and strengths. So three things that you're good at in data science and three things you're not that great at data science. It's a little bit of introspection, self-diagnosis. And if your list is too short on the weaknesses side, I'll let you know some suggestions. I think we're going to have it written out on paper, because this is a two-phase activity. So I didn't. No, you're not. So that's a very good question. You're not giving this paper to me. So it's only for your eyes. If you need pens or paper, I did come prepared this time with paper, so.
I feel like some of these is kind of like relative to where you're at. Right?
Oh, yeah. It's personal, right? It's where you're at currently today.
Like,
that you meant?
Compared to the average population, I'm probably good at math, but compared to, like, other data scientists, right?
Yeah, yeah. Paper and pen?
Just the pen.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely, so that it's a relative measure of your population that you're in, right? Ben? So this list, this is like me brainstorming things that I think I've tried to teach you in class. So it's not the exhaustive list of things where you have strengths or weaknesses. Paper or pen? Yeah. If someone else has other suggestions that they want to add on there, like I would totally be open to suggestions. So. Raise your hand if you're done. I think people are writing. So once you've got your list of the six things, so just to give you a little like foreshadowing of where is this going, right? The way to influence other data scientists is to identify their weaknesses and then address that gap. What's the head nod? All right, so part two of this activity is for each weakness that you listed, find someone else with that as a strength. And you have three weaknesses at least, and so you may need to find three different people to match those. Huh?
What?
So I know that someone in your right like weak sauce.
All right, so phase one of that could be.
You have to identify a gap that you have. Need some paper? Did you find your three weaknesses filled?
All three, yes. That is the game.
How's it got? You got all three filled up? No? All right, you got to find those three. So once you guys have three weaknesses, find someone who has those as strengths.
Did you get all three, Zach?
Yeah.
Yeah, give it like 2 more minutes and then back to your desk. Okay, so let's come back to our desk. Back to your desk. Okay, so for those of you who were working on this challenge, did anyone not get their weaknesses addressed by someone else who had a strength? No lack of matches. Is that the case? Okay, so what's the conclusion that you would draw from that, if anything?
Network means work.
All right, Hector comes through with the answer, right? In this group, I'm actually superfluous, right? I don't need to be here because everyone here has the skills needed to fill in the weaknesses of everybody else. That's pretty amazing, right? You didn't know that, but now you do. Right? And it happens all the time, right? If you have a sufficient enough cohort of people, all the skills needed are typically present if the group of people is sufficiently diverse. And this classroom of people, you all have sufficiently diverse backgrounds and motivations and interests, and therefore it's not that surprising that you can fill each other's weaknesses. Right, so that's like observation number one. Observation number two is you wouldn't know that if you didn't talk to anyone about their weaknesses and your weaknesses. And that's a really hard challenge. Is if you have a group of people who aren't like each other, the likelihood of them talking to each other about their skills and weaknesses is pretty low, right? So that's a hard barrier to overcome, but totally worth it because it means that as a group, you can take on challenges you could otherwise, as an individual, not solve. And that's super powerful. So the fun part is, like, as an organization or as a business unit, you can solve problems that the individual cannot. So that's cool. Right. And again, this is sort of like a social engineering issue of, like, once you figure out where that value trait is, right, you can provide someone value, they can provide you value. That's how you get a relationship going and trust and all that good stuff. And then you can have long relationships about how do I professionally engage with someone. It's by providing them value. Questions on, like, now that you've done that exercise, do you find it useful? Only yes, that's okay. Brad.
Let's see, yeah, but you also told us in the last class that typically never going to have this many data scientists and ever again, right?
Exactly. So how are you going to solve it? Like, this is great. How are you going to solve that problem? Yes. Okay. So wait, Brad pronounced this with a conundrum. How do we solve this problem? Conventions.
Websites.
Websites. What else?
Message board.
Message board, same thing. What else?
Books.
So if you haven't, this is a commercial today. I'm not advertising on their behalf, but I'm just saying there's this thing called Meetup. If you haven't been to meetup.com.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I use it all the time.
So finding people with shared interest doesn't restrict you to having to do it at work, right? You can do it in sort of a social setting of finding like-minded people and then networking with them. Again, just showing up at a networking event is not sufficient. You actually have to talk to the people at the networking event and figure out what their weaknesses are, which is a huge barrier, right? So even when you've solved this conundrum of how do you find a group of people with the skills that are relevant, you haven't actually solved the problem yet, right? It's just like a necessary but not sufficient. So.
The event forward with a meetup, right?
Huh?
The event forward with a meetup, right?
The event? You said slower.
I think you said like an event earlier.
Yeah. So there's lots of meetups in DC targeting data scientists, and I typically don't share those. If someone here lives near DC and wants me to share those with you, I can totally do that. But a lot of the
data science-y meetups are in Washington, D.C., and I don't want to force anyone to drive down there. So, but so, and then the last one I was going to suggest is professional organizations. If you're in a professional organization of like-minded people, they'll often have conferences or meetups, and so networking with people is definitely a strategic goal. UMBC, okay, so they're very scattery. They're not well announced, and they're pretty rare. So UMBC occasionally has data science type events, but typically those are triggered by some commercial entity wanting to hire people and therefore hosting the event as a sort of advertisement, right? So it's not there. I don't know if, I mean, I know there's computer science club, chess club, that sort of thing. I don't think there's a data science club. Yeah. So, let's see. Yeah. All right. So now we'll transition from soft skills to more technical skills. All right. So as we've explored previously in this class, just because you don't have data doesn't mean you can't make progress. Right? And so that's the whole fake data exercise. The same thing applies at the scaling concept, right? So I only have a megabyte of data. What would a gigabyte or a terabyte of data be like? Well, you just make copies of it, and then you have an answer, right? I mean, like, again, you can apply fake data not just to the structure or content, but also the scale. So that's pretty exciting, right? Because, like, it means, like, you can right now go home and play with a terabyte of data. You have the ability to generate a terabyte of data. Right? I'm not going to force it on you. It'll be close in the homework, but force it. All right. All right, so the problem that you'll run into once you take your CSV to more than a few megabytes is typically some sort of problem where I'm trying to load all this data from disk into memory as a variable, and my computer chokes. Right? That's totally normal. So don't feel bad when that happens. It happens to all of us. So there's some sort of plain text CSV that's like characters represented on disk. You can compress those and get pretty good compression rates for storage. But often you want to access it as a different data structure. So I think I've talked about Pickles before. That's a data serialization method. It also compacts the data a little bit. And then SQLite, again, it's a different data representation, but typically it's smaller on disk than CSV. So, and I think I'll cover that coming up shortly. But then another option for sort of a different data representation on disk that's more compact and more efficient is the HDF5. So this gets into handling more complicated sort of data structures. So the difference between like CSV and SQLite, right, is the fact that an SQLite database can handle multiple tables in one file. So that's handy. And the same thing with HDF5, it can handle multiple tables in one file and all the metadata associated with that, right? So let's say like my table has a description. I want that description to be associated with the table. So HDF5 can do that. So there's some advantages. But the other advantage to HDF5 is that once you've stored it in that data structure, you don't have to load all the data into memory to do transformations to it. So typically, we think of read the data off of disk, put it in memory, apply my transformations, write it back to disk. Right? That's the normal three-step process. But for HDF5, you can operate on really big things, because it's making the changes on disk, so that it doesn't have to load it in memory to do the transform and then write it back. So it can be a little bit more efficient in that sense. All right, I think I will open up this notebook and scroll through it quickly, but it's going to be pretty quick. So the advantage is that it can do some operations on disk, but I'm not going to show that. And then do a little quick demo. Yeah, so I like making slides and then verifying the slides are correct based on Python notebooks, so this is me doing that. Like, I actually wanted to see for myself, is this really an issue, right? How much savings is there? This is a thing that we can go off and measure, right? So there's a bunch of libraries here. I'm going to be sharing this with you so you can go play with it for yourself. One of the funny things to realize is, like, the data you're storing affects the compression capability of the data form of the data on disk.
And so like if you're storing all numerical data, it will compress better than text, right, which will compress better than images. So that data structure you're playing with impacts this, the compressibility of the data. So we're using H5PY and pandas and SQLite and Pickle, and those are all the things we use. Okay, so I'm going to make a not very large data frame, but it's got a million rows and four columns of numeric data. That will be just some fake data set, and you can scale that to however large you like. And then I'm also going to take I'm going to make a CSV of fake data, right? This should feel pretty familiar. I've got a bunch of columns. I'm going to do 8,500 rows of that data frame. And so it sort of looks like this. So it's text data. All right. And then I wanted to see how big is that on disk. So HDF5, there's a bunch of good websites there. I'm going to take that pandas data frame, and then I'm going to write it to disk at temp.h5 using this pandas HDFS store. It's super handy. Pandas, once you're in it, everything else is easy. And then I'm going to use this command os.path.gitsize to the operating system request to ask how big is the file on disk. And I'm going to divide from bytes to, I'm going to divide it by a million basically to get that megabyte. So it's 38 megabytes on disk. Okay, so that's how big my, I think it was the numeric data frame is 38 megabytes. And then I can just for just to validate, I could read it back in and verify that the data frame hasn't been corrupted. Okay, so that CSV of text, for whatever reason, it's smaller. So it's only 8,500 rows and it's 21 megabytes on disk. So this is just like a baseline. And then, yeah, a million by four for the numeric data. And then take the same data frame and dump it into an SQLite database, and it's 78 megabytes on disk. So why am I walking you through this? Well, because not only is it going to show up in your homework for you, but the point is that when you go off and you ask, how should I store this data on disk, it's useful to be able to calculate how much data storage will this take in a different format. So this is something that you can just go off and experiment and see like how much savings is there. So I use Pickles a lot. And that same the numeric data frame, let's see, so just for recall, it was 38 megabytes in HDF5. It's 30 megabytes in Pickle. So how much savings is there? Not a whole lot, so not too big of a draw. But then this is sort of where the differentiation comes in. So I can have multiple different data frames saved to the same file. So that's typically useful if I have thousands of data frames. I don't want to save each data frame to a different file. I want to bundle them all together in one structure. So HDF5 or Python serialization or SQLite could all do that, whereas CSV cannot. And in CSV, you have to have one file per table. So I won't belabor the point, but this notebook sort of walks through you being able to explore these different choices. Questions on that? Cool. So representation. All right. So we're covering a lot of different ground, right? We've talked about query scaling. We've talked about data representation on disk. There's different choices there. And then there's even choices of how do you represent your data in memory, right? So like one motivating use case, has anyone here done the document analysis in a different class? Because we did cover a little bit of the TF IDF in this class.
Yeah, Morgan. So if you're with a large number of documents, you might want to figure out how many words are in which document. And that basically constructs a large table, right? Documents like words. And so if you had a vocabulary, right? Like your spoken vocabulary is roughly 20,000 words. So how many you could expect to show up in a corpus of documents, and then maybe you have 100 files. So that's 2 million elements in a table, right? That's a lot of data, potentially. But even though this table is really big, most documents won't have every word in them. And so you'll have this sparse matrix. And that's a big keyword in linear algebra because it differentiates you from having a dense
representation from a sparse one, that means different algorithms will apply, and you have different efficiencies for how those algorithms will operate. So I'm not going to focus on the algorithm side of sparse matrix linear algebra. Tonight, I'm going to focus on just how do you even represent a sparse matrix where a lot of the entries are zeros. Can we do something more efficient than just having this giant table, right? Because giant tables are expensive. Okay, so not that you need to memorize this, but this is just to give you a sort of a flavor of the complexity that you face once you go down this route of making the choice of, well, not all the entries are filled, and so more compact representation, which more compact representation is better? Well, so we have these choices, right? Different representations of the same concept. So what, right? Well, how does this impact us? It means when you choose one of these, the algorithm that you're going to run against the data structure may be different. So there's all these downstream choice impacts, right? Of you chose this data set, it has this sparsity, we'll choose this sparse matrix representation. I won't read these off all into, but this is sort of like just a taste of the consequence here is you have to go and figure out which algorithms are going to apply against which of these things. And typically you want to use a library to read those data structures rather than trying to write your own. Okay, so again, hopefully someone else wrote these algorithms for you to read all those different representations, but that's a choice that you have to figure out. Am I willing to take someone else's library in a format that I maybe not would have chosen, or do I want to use the format I like and rewrite the algorithm? Again, there's a trade-off to make. Yeah. So that's just a taste of, like, I don't think many people will be doing sparse matrix manipulations here, so I'm not going to stray too much into that. Okay. So now we've talked about data formats, data representation, the why scaling matters for you, and then we'll do a little bit of performance measurement. I think that'll probably eat up the rest of our time. Maybe we'll do changing algorithms. All right, so the thing that I want to walk you through is you now have chosen a data structure, some files on disk, and you want to do some coding, right? So let's build an experiment to measure how that's going to scale. All right, so I'm going to have an algorithm that's pretty simple. So I have all my usual libraries, right? And then, let's see, my function that I'm going to time, how long it takes, is this really simple thing. I take a row out of a data frame, I multiply one of the elements by 2. This is a not very complicated algorithm. This isn't the part to worry about. The part to worry about is coming up. Right. So what I want to basically do is time how long it takes to use this algorithm at different scales. Right. So because there's some jitter, some variation in my computer, I'm going to run that same test at the same scale multiple times. Right. So I'll say, like, how many times, what is the timing if I do this algorithm against a data frame with 100 rows, we'll pump that time measurement 5 times. And then we'll do the same thing for a slightly larger scale, do the same test 5 times, detect some times, right? And like figure out how this code is going to scale when we run it against larger and larger data frames. Okay, hopefully it ran. I don't know. So these are basically the choices of parameters I'm making. And then there's this really messy block of code that I'll step you through. Okay, so I want to iterate over 2 nested loops, right? The outer loop is basically that set of how big is my data frame. And then the inner loop is how many tests at each scale am I doing. Right, now I'm doing a test, and I'm inside both loops. I'm doing a test of the timing. So I'm going to create a data frame, and this data frame has random entries in the range of 0 to 1,000. And there are however many rows by 4 columns. This is, again, a rectangular data frame and numeric data. And then I'm just naming the columns here. So this is my creation of data frame. I don't want to care about how long that takes to do. That's not that's important to me. I'm timing how long this function takes. And so I'm going to start this
stopwatch, basically just before I take the data frame and apply the function to it. And then I stop my stopwatch after I've done the function. So now I've timed how long that takes for a given data size frame. That's the answer. I'm going to put it in a list. And then I can take that list of timings. Right? I did 5 experiments at the same scale. And then I can put that in a dictionary. So let's say I did 100 rows. That took, on average, the number of elements in the list divided by the total number of tests that I did. And that's the average time for those 5 rows. It's a lot of code for a relatively straightforward concept, hopefully. If you have any questions, you should not be lost in this. If you're lost, you should definitely raise your hand. Everybody's good.
So what? So
I timed this function 5 times for 100 rows, and it took 0.24 seconds, and then I timed it for a slightly larger thing. And as a sanity check, it took about 10 times as long. Right? You'll notice that step of 10 there. And then again, roughly a size of 10 step in the timing. So that's cool.
All right, so 13.88 seconds to do just apply method against this relatively simple thing, right? So why does this matter? Because typically you're going to be doing something slightly more complicated than this transformation. And so when you say, well, I'm going to write this complicated function, but then I'm going to run it against a data frame that has 10 million rows in it. How long will that take? I don't know. Right? And the answer is you have to time it. How long does it take for 10 rows? How long does it take for 100 rows? How long does it take for 1,000 rows? Take those 3 data points, put it on a plot, and then do the math to figure out how long it will take you for however large data size you have. Right? This is a really fundamental concept in making sure that your algorithm is either going to run during break, during lunch break, or you know overnight, or never. Right? Like, anything over 30 days is never, by the way. All right. So I've got some results.
I've got this nice handy dictionary structure. So it's got that 100 rows took that long on average, right, for 5 runs.
And so I can put that in a really nice little plot, and I can put a little even
visual guide for the line. So I'm pretty happy. All right. So this is how I verify that my code is going to run in a reasonable amount of time on a data structure that's really big.
Questions? We're happy. All right. I think that's, oh yeah. So that was the answer that I wanted to get you to. And I'm going to leave the rest of this for your amusement and enjoyment, because basically I did not sit down and write this code. Right? This is not like a one-time step through, write code, walk away, right? How did I actually do it? Like, this looks like a relatively straightforward thing, right? You write a function, you put in some parameters, you do this test, you make a plot. It's all good, right? That's what Ben does. No, that's a lie, right? Because I want to show you that this is a lie. The real work, right? This part here, this is the steps that I actually did in sequential order, right? But it's you'll notice over here on the little slider bar, there's a lot more code that I'm not showing you in lecture, right? So typically this is the thing that I would show you, and it's like, it's magic. But the actual truth is, there's a bunch of iterative development, right? First, I have to figure out, well, what does time.time do? Okay, it does that. Well, what if I create a random data frame? Okay, how big is that? And then, like, looking through that, okay, here's a function. And then, like, let's apply this thing to, let's apply that function to the data frame, verify it, get back out, right? So, like, this whole iterative sequence of commands, that's the rest of the notebook. So that's, like, the underside of the iceberg, if you're familiar with that analogy. Okay, so you can read through that at your own leisure. The whole point is, what I got as an output is over here, but that's not the whole story. Okay. Let's go back to the slide. Okay, and we will have enough time. So I'm going to skip concurrency. That'll be your treat for next time. It's also pretty exciting. All right. So what I have basically shown you is that I can time how long it takes to do an implementation. Okay, that's what programmers do, right? But if you're a computer scientist, maybe you're aware of this idea that you can do the same thing multiple different ways. Now you have choices about how to do different implementations that achieve the same outcome. Why would we care about that? Because some of those different methods, approaches of solving the same problem take more or less time,
or more or less memory, right, and different trade-offs of storage. So I'm going to show you an example of that quickly.
It's relatively straightforward, right? It's a question of, I give you this list, and then I ask you where in that list is the value 2. That's a, again, overly simplistic problem, but maybe we could solve it using this algorithm, right? This is my algorithm. I'm like, just look through all the elements in the list and figure out where the 2 is, and then print out where the index. That's a pretty straightforward algorithm, right? What could possibly go wrong?
We're in a class on scaling, by the way. Okay, just me. All right. So before we get to the demo, the sort of computer science-y side tangent that I will not take you down too far is big notation. If somebody has a computer science background, they will invariably talk to you about this in your data science career, and you'll be like, I don't care, right? But you should care a little bit, right? Just enough to understand why they're talking to you about it. Typically, they want to tell you that the algorithm you're using is wrong, you should do something else. That's why they're telling you this. So in order for you to be sufficiently conversant with big O notation for your scientist, this is sort of keywords that you should understand, right? An algorithm is composed of a sequence of steps, and you want to know how long each of those steps take. Analyzing more data takes longer. That's kind of obvious. All right. So what? So big O notation is telling you about when you step through an algorithm as a sequence of paths, how long should that take on average per step, right? And then you calculate how much the total time is for the algorithm, and then you can have sort of the shape of how long does it take for different algorithms, right? So this algorithm may be running faster, and this, What you want to figure out is what's going to happen when I run my algorithm. But so
computer scientists go through and make these fancy charts. You typically don't care.
Why is that?
Because you operate at such small scale that you're usually not bitten by inefficiency. The consequences of inefficiency are not relevant when you're operating on really small scale data. You don't care if it takes you 1 second versus 10 seconds. It's trivial. Right? But that mindset does not work when you're operating at really large scale. The difference between 1 day and 10 days is significant. Right? So where the sort of like consequence of being on this line versus this line starts to matter, right? That how long does it take to do that? Doesn't matter at small scale. Okay, so I'm going to show you a quick example of what I mean by that. So how hard is it to break Python? Okay, let's run this. Okay, I'm trying to remember whether one of these cells takes forever or not. I think it does. Yes, okay, so I'm not going to run this notebook live. But we'll walk through it. So basically, I have a, back to that problem I was describing to you, I have a list. I want to find where in the list is a specific element. So I can write relatively straightforward examples of that.
I have a list of size 7 elements. I can find one of the values. Okay, so Python has this handy dandy dot index function or method built in to list structures. And so like if you just ask it, where is this value, it will tell you location in the list. So that's probably like the safest thing to go with, right? If Python has it implemented, just use that. Typically safe. Or we could go with this algorithm that I invented, that's really, we'll call it brute force, right? It actually steps through every element of the list and says, is this the thing that I care about? Nope, go to the next one, right? So that's this for loop. It's going over all the elements of the list, checking whether the value is equal to the thing we care about, and if it is, spit back the location of that file, of the element. So here I'm looking for
I'm taking a list and I'm going to pass it. I want to know where is the location of the third element, and it turns out that the third element is index equals 3.
Okay, so there's a bunch of other options for the same search algorithm, and so I'm not going to go through all of them in detail. They're on this handy dandy website called Rosetta Code. If you haven't been there, I totally recommend it. It's an awesome site. It basically translates a given algorithm across a bunch of different languages. So like if you want to know like how would you do it in Ruby or Python or Java, right, or C or assembly or everything else, like a given algorithm is implemented multiple different languages, and sometimes for some algorithms they have multiple implementations within that language. So I, being very lazy, stole multiple different implementations of search algorithms off of that web page. So that's where I'm making these things up from. Okay, so basically this is the same. What do you mean hit rate? Oh, very low. There's many more algorithms that are implemented on Rosetta Code, but most of the common ones are implemented. So it depends on whether you're wondering about common algorithms or all possible algorithms.
Well, I just meant like if you gave it
something. Rosetta Code is not designed to do that. It's basically a list of all the codes. Okay, so basically all these, I'm going to show you a couple different things. The names don't matter too much. It's an iterative binary search and a recursive binary search. Those are sort of the competitors to the Ben Payne brute force algorithm that I wrote and the index version, right? Okay, so what are we going to do? Well, just like we built that up, that experiment, right, that we looked at different scales, right? So we could rerun that again, right? Same thing. So I'm going to time the same algorithm at the same scale three times. That's what this three is up here for. And I'm going to have longer and longer lists. So that'll be the thing I'm scaling up. The longer the list, the longer it should take to search for a specific value in that list, right? So far, is it good? Okay. So then all of this is sort of the mechanics of that same test, but I'm having some extra list here to store the results. And so what do we have? We have I'm calling the index method. That's the one that Python has it built in. And then I have the sequential search. That's my unpainted brute force naive method. And then I have this binary search iterative method and the binary search recursive. So I'm just calling the same function on the same list with the same value defined, not storing the output. I don't care what the result is. I just care how long it is, right? And so that's why I'm wrapping each one of these in a timer to figure out how long that thing took. Everybody lost yet? Yeah. Got one yes? You're lost? Okay. So I'm going to store all these results.
It takes almost, what is that, 3 minutes? A little over 3 minutes
to do the largest one, which is why I didn't let it run in the background. And so then I can look at the results. So that's
my lazy output here is that I have, for a given list length of 10,000 elements, it took nearly 0 seconds to search through that with the four different methods that I'm describing here. And so that's sort of like the simple result. It takes very little time. And if I switch from 10,000 elements to 100,000 to 1,000,000 to 10 million elements, right, the binary search and binary iterative and recursive take almost no time as far as Python can figure out relative to how long it takes the built-in method index and then my method, which takes really long, right? So the average time of 2.5 seconds to go through 10 million elements in a list. So the point here is not that you should use, you know, these methods for searching through lists. The point of this whole discussion was to tell you that you can do scaling comparisons of different algorithms to figure out how well they work. That was the takeaway. All right.
So basically, then if you can compare, sort of like throw out those other two algorithms that are super slow, at least the list of length 10 million, there wasn't that much of a difference between binary search recursive versus iterative, so don't care. But that wasn't very visible in this plot, so. Okay, so we're all happy. Got a few minutes left to finish up the slides and homework. Okay, so the takeaway here for me, like one of my messages is like default to brute force. Like the naive method is super easy to understand and comprehend. And if you don't care that much about whether it takes 10 seconds or 10 minutes, that's fine, right? Like just be lazy, do brute force, don't try to be clever. Clever is bad, unless you're going to a scale where the clever matters. Okay, and sample with small data, skip over that. Let's skip over all these guys. All right, perfect. So now we're at the homework. As I alluded to, there's some complexity, right? So you're gonna be doing something similar to what I was talking about in class, except you're gonna be figuring out how slow your computer is when you're writing files to disk and reading files from disk. Some squinty eyes, some head nods. All right, so
So we're going to write a bunch of CSVs. So we're just going to stick with CSVs, no data format changes here. And then we're going to change the size of the file. But I didn't tell you exactly how to create that file, so that'll be up to you. Right, I put on some constraints. Okay, so then, so my goal for you is, some of you will get stuck at the point where you're trying to generate a 500 megabyte CSV, and it's going to take too long. It's going to take hours. And then you're going to be like, wait, Ben said not to do that. So there's going to be some cleverness, potentially. If you have something other than a magical computer, you will need to be a little bit smarter about how you make a 500 megabyte CSV. So I'm warning you, brute force creation of a CSV line by line, element by element will not work. So if you get stuck, email me and say, Ben, I got stuck. How do I get out? That's what I'm here for. I get paid to do that, right? Answer your emails. Questions? So far, looking. All right. So we're going to make really big files, and we're going to write them to disk, and then we're going to read them in from disk. We're going to time how long that takes. And this basically is telling you the read-write capacity of your drives in your computer. So different people have different drive speeds. They'll get different answers. Don't worry about that part. You should get relatively linear scaling for the most part. And then I want to see a plot of your load read and write times. Right? Questions on that homework? So that's okay.
So you're going to have to break that down, obviously, like, you know, as always, I'm going to skip over this slide, but you should definitely not do this task in like one cell in your notebook. You should take more than one cell. That's not a requirement, but it's highly suggested. Right? And plan it out. Right? Don't just sit there and say, I will write code and it will be done. Like, you have to actually think about how to do the problem first. Okay, so this is a separate thing. There's also an assignment, but it's a little bit squishier. So we're going to talk about it for just a few minutes. Okay, so this goes back to scaling and costing sort of things. The challenge here is, you know, a lot of people will tell you the cloud is cheaper, it's better than having a hosted solution or your own, right? And like blah, 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 total cost ownership, blah, blah, blah. And so you have to figure out, where is the BS, right? Are they actually telling the truth? Or is this actually, you know, someone being confused? So the way that we're going to answer that, we're going to take a survey. And the survey is you go out and get some data points. And then we're going to aggregate them as a class, and we'll see, I'm going to ask you the same questions. So hypothetically, everyone should get the same answer, right? But I almost guarantee that you will not. Now, we'll talk about why that is next week, but there's a couple of assumptions here. That you're living in Maryland, that's a true statement. And then I'm going to talk about having the service for a year. So that's like time bounding it. Location, time, those are the things.
And then we're going to talk about different providers, right?
So you go to the common ones. If you find a different provider and want to talk to them, that's cool. No beef.
Okay, so here's the specifics. I want you to take everybody for your. Oh, yeah, so this is our two questions. So I want you to get storing 1 terabyte for 1 year and also storing 100 terabytes for 1 year.
So two separate sort of A and B tasks.
And then for the compute question, I want 20 cores. I want 1 terabyte of RAM and I want 5 GPUs.
Right? Why would I ask that specific question? It's because typically you can solve a thing that fits on your desktop on your desktop. So you typically need something more than a desktop when you're moving data science into the cloud.
Right? If you could solve it on your desktop, there's no motivation to go to the cloud. So the transition phase is when you need something larger.
So this is what I'm calling larger. I want you to be able to fulfill that for a year. Right? So far, so good. All right. And then
it's not enough to have storage in the cloud, and it's not enough to have compute in the cloud. You have to get your data into the cloud, which they charge you for. Right? And so you have to figure out the data movement portion of the cost. That has to be built into your model.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to give you some starting points so that everyone is sort of on a fair footing. John?
Do you want it in like literal dollars?
Yes. So the assumption here is that I want these answers for a year.
So I'm going to be doing my data science project for a year. Does that make sense? So I'm storing either a terabyte or a 100 terabytes for a year. I'm having this compute for a year, and I'm moving this up in a year.
Good question. All right, so these are your starting points.
If you find something else, let me know, but
I'm just going to start you on the most common ones here. Okay.
The last one, this is like option number four. This is the one that will probably be the hardest, so I apologize in advance, but I just want a computer, right? I don't want the cloud, I want a computer. And so this is the computer I want. It happens to be the same thing, right? For bonus points, if you really want, you can figure out how much power it's going to take. Not super, you know, important at this point, but getting a computer like that will be the starting point. All right, so who's doing what? I think you know what month your birthday is in. That will determine what you're doing. Okay, yeah? So we're going to have who here was born in April. I want to volunteer. We got two people there. That's good. So you two will be working on the answers for the cloud part in Microsoft. Yes, yes. Okay, so and then who here is in August? One? Okay, so Zach, you're in Amazon. Whoever else is in July and September, you're also doing Amazon. All right, and then the self-hosted are other people for those 3 months. And then what I want, like what are you going to upload? It's going to be an Excel spreadsheet that looks something like this table, but not with these values. Your values will be different. So we're going to have the aspects that I was looking for. For self-hosted, you're not going to have these parts, but you will have the cost per year. And then where did you get this? Right? If you just tell me Amazon.com, I'm not going to be happy. What I want is the actual website where you got the information that you were looking up. Okay? And then, like, if you have some notes or something, I just throw that in there. But this is the Excel table format that I'm looking at from each person. And I'm going to do the work of aggregating all of that up. And we'll see what the results are next week class. Yeah. So that's what we're looking for. Yeah. Okay. That's it. Any questions on the assignment? Stunned silence.
Yes. I don't want the files.
Yes,
yes. So your notebook should be able to generate. Yeah. I don't want the same one.
So you were born in June, which means you're in this column, so you're going to work on the solution for Microsoft. So you're going to have to figure out what is the Microsoft solution for the hardware one? Right. Yeah.
Programming?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes.
Ben, after this assignment, is this the last assignment?
Why would it be the last? This isn't the last class.
So we have.